Wednesday, June 17th meeting of the Community Preservation Committee. First item on the agenda is general public comment, which noted the absence of public. Move on to the chair's report because there are no minutes to approve at this point. So the chair's report, the city clerk has taken note of the fact that no Northampton citizen has taken out nominating papers for the two elected positions. The deadline to submit papers is 5 o'clock on July 24th. So,
the whole month.
I would ask that if you are coming to the committee from one of our boards that is statutorily allowed to send a member, that you might reach out to your interest group within the community. So people who, obviously, Conservation Commission, there are people that might be interested in open space issues, but David's not here, but I'll be talking or emailing him, but also anyone that you might think of in the community, housing community, who might wish to step forward, since it is an important position, and it is important that we have good people to fill those elected positions. The next item is just reporting on the legislation, which is currently before the conference committee. It did have a greater number of sponsors in the Senate than would be required for a majority vote, which was good. I'm not sure that it had a majority in the House, but it was certainly significant. And what they have to boil down is whether or not they wish to do the amount set aside from surplus, or the other mechanism that was proposed in the amendment was to do basically an adjustment to the registry fees so that they would maintain it at a certain minimum match. So I think that that's what they're handing out in conference committee. We have also been invited to the Jackson Street School Playground. I think you may have all gotten this email, or maybe not. So I got some other officials did. But if you have it, it's on Monday, June 22nd, between 3 o'clock and 4 o'clock in the afternoon, rain or shine. They will be celebrating with cake and lemonade.
Has it been constructed? Or is it just
it's the groundbreaking. Built as much as possible over the summer. And the last item on the chair's report is that after a long and enjoyable sojourn as your chair and on this committee, I am going to be redirecting my energies to my day job more, and also to school committee, since we'll be going into negotiations with the association for another 3-year contract. So I'm going to be stepping down from Conservation Commission, which means I will also be stepping down from this committee as well before the beginning of the next round. So I'll be here during the summer, which means that you all must think about who is a worthy successor to me.
Well, I would say it's been a treat working under you.
Oh, second, the pleasure has been entirely mine. I thank you for tolerating my accidental.
Can we go on the record by with
resistance?
Yeah. No, I'm not allowing it. So with that bit of business, can move into the small projects discussion. So I think you had been emailed once and emailed twice the amended materials that Dave came up with. I will note, I'm not sure whether I should note this, one bit of new information. So the $5,000 amount, I'm not sure how this will affect your consideration, but the $5,000 amount, that's a matter of policy, not of statute. And so the city has recently changed its policy from $5,000 to $10,000. So $10,000 is the amount that is requires a contract. So we want to roll that into our discussion, because as I look down my list of starred items, the starred item number one I saw, which required further consideration, was the amount. And I think that that was two discussions, actually. One was the amount of our grant, and then there was also the amount of the total project budget. So, Dave, I'll turn it over to you if you'd like to lead us forward on this.
Sure. Pull up the last version I had with comments. One thing. So, based on our conversation the last time, I went back and reworked as much of this as I could, where there were points of agreement, and then obviously there are points where we decided we still needed to think it over or vote next time. So Downey identified the first one, which is the amount that we'd like to see. And in that respect, folks were kind of all over the place when we last met and wrote down where we were at the time. I think we had one individual who was looking at $499 as being the total amount, which would include in-kind as well as CPC, as the total project cost. We had another individual who agreed. We had one individual who wanted it to be $5,000 for CPA, up to $10,000, so up to a $5,000 match. We had another individual who wanted to keep the CPA portion at $3,000, and my notes don't reflect whether or not that was total project cost or not. We had another $5,000/$10,000, and we had one at $2,500, which is total project cost of $5,000. So I guess that's where we need to.
So can I ask, just in the interest of focusing discussion, since we were trying to get this wrapped up, would anybody be willing to make a motion? And again, we would obviously discuss it, amend it as necessary, but to make a motion that would include the total project budget and the CPA amount. I mean, obviously, we've got a big range, so. But anyone venture?
We say the range again. It was 3 to 10.
2,500 to. It depends on how you split it. It was anywhere from 2,500. It's just the CPA portion. To 10,000 was the total project cost with different variants of contributions and as part of that equation.
And at that point, we didn't know that the 10,000 was the contract amount.
Correct.
Before I make a motion, it would seem to me that something under the 10,000 that would accommodate the matching grant money, so that we're back down to something we were all comfortable with, which was about $5,000, and they've got to come up with some in-kind. So my question is that the total project cost, or is the CPA project cost the contract?
Well, that's again where there was wide divergence of opinion, because we had some people who thought that it should be.
Oh no, I'm asking the clerk the question of the,
oh,
of the city's
the contracted amount. Well, we would only be signing a contract for the CPC. Actually, we don't sign contracts anymore, but we would be approving a contract of $10,000 from, I believe, they're from us, right?
Yeah.
So we don't, I mean, you don't.
So that's when it gets to be more formal. Below 10, which 2 weeks ago was 5, we can just do an MOU where someone can sign it, but over that, then we start getting.
And I'm just verifying that if the project included $5,000 of in-kind expenses, so the whole project amount was $15,000.
Yeah, no, that wouldn't matter. It's just how much we're.
I just want to get that straight.
It's just the city.
I would move to set the limit at $5,000 for CPC, $10,000 for the project.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
All right. So Discussion.
I'm leaning on the higher end. I would just, for the sake of discussion, I just think it's a great way to get more smaller projects. I can feel different after a couple of years' experience in it, and we're just, you know, $40,000 or $50,000 is slipping away from us every round. Then I'd feel like maybe we'd done a round this small. But I mean, that's the opposite end. I'm not interested in going much lower than that, than the five.
The other discussion I think we had, or my notes aren't clear, is whether we were going to set a limit on the total number of small grants per round, and that might affect my thinking on this. What do your notes reflect on that?
That's an open question, whether we limit the number or limit the amount or set aside money or what we have.
But nowhere is that in the proposal that you wrote, correct?
Correct.
Because we hadn't resolved. So if you're at a couple of maximum dollar amount, then I'd be fine with increasing. Just some way that there's some limits, because there've been, we have obligated so much of the future dollars for a while. I'd just like to make sure we had enough available for some bigger things.
Well, the way that Dave has written it is that we have the option to fund immediately and submit to City Council the first meeting of the cycle, or alternatively to make an initial recommendation but wait until the close of the funding run. Is that correct? Either way.
At the end of our last meeting, it seemed like people had come around to the corner, but we decided to leave it open so that we could consider it after people had given it more thought.
But at the time of doing the small grants, we'll know what other applicants there are. We won't have decided on it, but we will know what's in the pipeline at that point. The deadline would have passed.
Right, assuming we want to stick with having it, you know, perfect the round.
Right.
So did you discuss the specifics? I know you're talking about, like, is there a limit? How much did you discuss, like, a set aside, like, $50,000? I mean, is that what you mean?
Are we guaranteeing some
portion of our resources towards this?
I mean, if you think of going up to $10,000 CPA?
The downside is I think it will create a few projects will create a noticeable hunk of money going out. Mm-hmm. I think you've done a beautiful job of writing this up and giving us all of this to chew on, and I'm not sure that there's a wrong answer here. I mean, you know, if next year we have to talk about this again, that's fine. So I guess that's where I think about that. I'm not really wanting to set a limit. The whole point of this was to try to get some enthusiasm from people doing small, important little projects.
But if you set a limit like $50,000, do you really think you're going to get that many projects that you're going to be saying no?
I don't think still at the beginning of it. If it catches on, we could.
Well, depending on the amount of the grant that you set, you increase the likelihood that you'll bump up against that.
That's true.
So,
perhaps increase the interest in buying.
If we adopt this, it would go into our plan at the end of the calendar year, is that correct?
It would go in as soon as the plan is approved.
And we have to do it by the end of the calendar year?
It should be done, it needs to be done by the end of the calendar year. It should be done, especially if we're going to be making substantial changes to the application procedure before the next round.
Okay. So if we submitted something that wasn't working, can we change the plan, mid-plan?
Sure.
We can do whatever we want.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
We can't just do this as an amendment to the current plan so that we don't have to get...
We could. I mean, we've done it before with when we invented the expedited review.
Yeah, we just added
from whole cloth, and we just, for a while, just sat as an had to sort of sat out. There was an appendix, and then we integrated it so we could.
Since this has been pending for a long time, it
right.
seemed to me, you know, why not
There's no
untether
reason.
It from the rest of the plan,
right.
go ahead and
yep.
get it in place.
When we did Phragmites removal for BBC, for Bistro, like, how much was that? What did we find for that?
They received grants for invasives removal 3 times, and I think the last
time was how much?
The first one, I think, was $12,000 or $13,000.
There was one for $7,000,
and the last one
for like $2,000.
Yeah, the last one was maybe the most limited.
So it was $13,700 and $1,300.
Yeah, the small patch of bright white.
Anyway, my perspective, again, having done the research from all the other towns are doing, is I would like this to go forward with a much smaller number. I'm not comfortable with 10,000 for one of these projects for a couple of reasons. I'm more in the $2,500 to $3,000 range for something that's truly small, that we can see it's immediately implemented, it stands alone. And most importantly, the risk of something going wrong. You know, if this is expedited, we don't have the ability to ask questions. We don't have the ability to really vet things. The people aren't here. You know, the bigger the project and the bigger the money, the bigger the consequences if it doesn't go well. And it's a different process. So I would rather ground truth it with the small, and if it seems like it's working, then potentially expand as opposed to start it big and try to work back out.
There's a flip side to that though, Dave, and that is if you get it too small, people just aren't that serious. They just they come up with an idea, they pitch it, and then they just don't get the energy behind it. I'm not arguing for 10. I'm perfectly happy with the motion as it stands, but I'm wanting it to be big enough to actually make some difference. And so, you know, I loved your list of things, but. Invasive control at $2,000, you know, our experience is, you know, 10 times that.
Well, we also had experience where it was half that.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it doesn't preclude them from using the regular cycle, and it doesn't preclude them from using expedited or something like that. So it's, that's just my perspective.
Yeah, I guess I have a sort of similar feeling in that I was talking to Sarah earlier, and one of my concerns is that when we have applicants before us, one of the things that I spend a lot of time trying to figure out is the applicant competent to carry the project through to completion? Because obviously we don't have any way, usually, or we don't institute a way to prevent them from drawing down CPC money first. And so if they draw down CPC money first, and they get halfway through the project, and the donation, you know, or the in-kind work doesn't materialize, then you have a project that's half done, and there's no public benefit, and it doesn't seem like the community's done its job. And I think that it will be very difficult just on, you know, we're trying to make this relatively straightforward on a paper application for us to go behind that and ask the questions that we did or that we do of many applicants to verify whether or not they're going to pull up the project. And I can just, as far as that amount, I mean, working at a school, I write grants for $500 and feel very happy when I get $500. I mean, $4,000 or $5,000 is, I mean, I can have some real impact with that. So. And as Dave said, it doesn't preclude us. So I think 5,000 is probably as high as I would want to go in terms of putting money out there. And I do think if we go higher, it does have more of a potential, since we are going to be in a lean situation for a while, to impact on other projects.
I understand the process a little better. I thought generally we paid on invoices or.
Right, so we will approve a project and then the invoices will be sent to Sarah. Sarah will look at the invoice to see whether it's consistent with the project as outlined in the contract. But there usually isn't anything that says, you know, if they've said we're going to have $5,000 from donors and $20,000 from another grant, we don't necessarily ask for verification that that money has hit their bank account. We just usually will say, you know, again, for instance, for community housing, we don't say, please show us, you know, come to us with evidence that you've actually gotten DHCD's approval for the project.
Because we ask for certification? Because I think Dave was saying that the in-kind had to be in hand. Because you can't do that with donated money, donated approval.
Yeah, but I don't think that diminishes your larger point, which is we don't have any way, if it's a standalone, one-time application, to validate whether or not it truly has the wherewithal.
Or, I mean, they can bring us certification, bring us the nicest letter from the person, and the person dies. And then, you know, they were going to do something, they need a heavy equipment operator, and the guy said, I'm going to do it, and then dies. And it's not, I mean, it's not even through a bad act. It's just through, they're not a big organization with a big track record with a lot of resources other that they can draw from. I mean, it could just be a neighborhood group that's gotten together and they want to, you know, maybe improve this one area, you know, an old detention basin that could be improved with plantings. So I just think because we're trying to make it quick that I wouldn't want to commit, you know, really large. And I think for a lot of people, looking from the, for us, when we're dealing with much larger amounts, 5,000 seems like a relatively small amount, but I think there are people who might perceive, you know, the CPC is giving $5,000 to people who submitted a page, they might think of that as a larger grant.
Okay.
More than that, for the Northampton Educational Foundation, what is the size limit? Is there a size limit?
I think when I looked at it the other day, I think $3,000 is their max. So, which I think is pretty typical for, you know, when you're an individual teacher applying, that seems to be, I don't know what your experience is, but if you're not doing if you're not backed by an institution, then that's about the size of the grant you're going to get.
So we currently have a proposal to do it at 5,000 for the CPC.
Five, yeah.
And 10 for the total. Matching total.
Right.
Why would we need the characterization of the 10? If they could get 10 more, what? My 5,000 may seed money for much more. Why would I care about that limit?
I think our intent was to limit the scope of the project.
Right.
Right.
We don't want $100,000 project coming in, which they secured 95.
Right.
We want a manageable project that we feel is.
Yes, I feel differently about that. I'd love to have my $5,000 CPC money turn into a bigger project and have CPC associated with it. But it's not a small project. Otherwise, okay. Yes, thank you. I've clarified my thinking. It's because of the separate process.
Right.
Dave, are you comfortable with that proposal?
I would feel more comfortable either the way it's written. So it's a total of five, or maybe do 3,000 with a total project cost of 6,000 so that I can match up to it. Just in the initial years to see what we get. As I think about, you know, bird boxes or benches, even when we did the stuff down at the skate park, we were talking about, you know, a bunch of us raised questions about, you know, would you want bleachers? They said, you know, if we had 1,000 or 2,000, we could put bleachers on. And so most of the things that are on that list, and depending on the scope of invasive species, you know, could fall in there, but it could fall out. But I feel like you could still accomplish a lot with that small amount. I would feel more comfortable with probably 3 and 6. 35, 7, but 5, 10 makes me uncomfortable because if we get around with, you know, 4 or 5 applicants, we're looking at $10,000 projects. That's a much bigger chunk of our initial outlay.
We're not looking at 10, that we're looking at 5,000 projects.
Yeah, I'm back with you.
So I just want to make sure that because the motion was for 5 of CPC money, 10 total.
Right.
So you're saying the impact of the 10, even...
Right, yeah. That right.
The impact of the 10 would
bigger,
be significant.
Yeah.
Not necessarily our outlay.
Our outlay, right. I could probably be convinced to go anyway because I just want to see this succeed. But I think from a sense of prudence as an initial starting point, small is good, and I don't think that necessarily be any less successful.
Well, and the way you wrote it, I'm looking at your language now, is that the entire project be under 5,000. And you were thinking that did involve, it didn't have to, but that it did involve some like kind within that amount.
Right. It was actually based on your suggestion last time, which was you could have a project that solely sought CPA dollars up to 5,000 or 49.99. Or you could have a total project cost of $49.99 with any amount being contributed as matching. So you could do 2,500, 2,500, or 1 and 4, or 4 and 1.
Fine.
Well, I've been persuaded by your desire to democratize this and get a lot more people participating and interested and feeling like they're benefiting from their CPA dollars. So I appreciate the notion that it's harder to shrink once you opened it up, but I would start it at the 5,000 a little bit bigger and make it more enticing and see where that goes.
As I'm reading Dave's, I like the way that's written actually. I'm not worried about the size of the project, set it at 5,000 and then, you know, we would look more favorably if that $5,000 had matching kind in it. But that would keep the project at the comfort level Dave's after, which is smaller projects. And if they're bigger than that, they come through the other pipeline.
So you're saying $5,000 total project cost?
Yeah.
That discourages looking for donated help or whatever. And so that could mean more drawn than CPA dollars. You can get it all by writing out a piece of paper. Why are you going to go, you know, call up your friends and neighbors and say, pitch in and help?
So it seems like Dave's suggestion that 3,000 to 6,000 total is kind of a midway point for that, where they're getting a chunk from us, and when we think about doing NEF, that's their max, and what people can really do with that when they have no resources, and that can be something significant when they had nothing to serve it. And then knowing, you know, and we can double this if we can get the in-kind or whatever we can to document it. It's sort of midway. I still have this question of whether or not you had any discussion around, is there some idea of set aside or something? Because oftentimes small things don't get funded. So is it that we just anticipate that we're looking at these favorably and then beyond this committee, is that understood when new people are on this committee, or is there actually like up to this much per round will be considered? Is there a limit, and is there the specific set aside so people kind of feel assured that they're not coming in and competing with the big dollars?
I think our discussion, correct me, it was about a maximum, not a specific set aside that could only be used for, or would be released, I guess, if there were no call for those dollars.
Well, when we first broached this a year or two ago, this was one of the things that was on the table, and I think there was probably a 70-30 split on the board as to whether or not a set aside made sense. I thought it would signal to people who are doing small grants who might apply that the money is reserved specifically for that purpose at the beginning of the round, so they knew how much was available. It would also give us the ability to say no if we were oversubscribed in any round. But the majority of folks said we don't want to be borrowing from the larger amount, we don't want to necessarily set it aside. So I mean, we can revisit it or think about it in terms of the max that we do, but I don't know that we got any further in the discussion than that.
So my thinking comes from working for Hilltown CDC. We've had a significant effort to have, there's a rural initiative that's actually statewide, but it really is about considering these places that have just a different parameter for doing housing development, affordable housing development, and if we're competing with Boston and Worcester applicants, we just never can compete, our costs are different. So that, that's been taken up by legislators, legislation, and it's moving forward that, like, you're right, you know, you need a pot just for you guys to work through yourselves, because otherwise, what do you get? You just don't get it. So I'm interested in that. I mean, it doesn't have to be that high. We could say 25,000, you know, it doesn't have to be that high depending on what we come up with for a limit, just so that there is some assurance of, like, I'm not doing this and I'm competing with, you know, Pulaski Park. You know, it's just, how would we ever make a decision around that? Like, whoops, this extra 3,000, you know, sorry, we can't.
I mean, the way I think it might work in, and the way that it's currently proposed to be set up, is we would do our recommendations on that first meeting of each round. And so in some respects, there's first dibs for the small projects. If we give that recommendation and we agree to forward them to council in advance of everything else, there's no real reason for a set aside because they have first dibs anyways. I think what would be important is if we have a round like last time, where we intentionally tried to spend out all the money from around. You know, we had 180,000 left, and we were like, well, how much should we save for operating costs in case there's a buffer, that you would want to be cognizant if you wanted to have a pool for the next year's small grants, that you always make sure from round to round that you're reserving that.
I feel that by designating a process for small grants and naming it, it's not fitting your set aside money logic, but by handling it first and by making it, you know, very streamlined, I think it's doing that. Yeah. I think we'd entice you to come.
Yeah.
It's never been my experience that something below $5,000, and it may change because we have less money now, has not been funded because it's too expensive. It's usually because they just have not been projects that were particularly well thought out. And I guess that I would be less comfortable with setting aside the pool because I wouldn't want them to think that they're entitled. I mean, I guess the mechanism, we have to reserve our 10%, but that money goes into the reserve and it stays there. And so, you know, if you're an advocate for community housing or open space or recreation, you know that if the committee can't get out of giving that money eventually to your program area. Whereas in this case, I mean, I guess it would only take a couple rounds or maybe one round where we made the set aside, but then we had, let's say, a half dozen mediocre projects that the committee decided, yeah, none of these really meet the standard. I mean, because it's still, from the, you know, my perspective, if you're spending $30,000, that's a lot of money. That pays a classroom teacher almost for, you know, for a couple ESPs for a year. So it's, if we didn't award that money, then I think that would kill the program. Because I think people would just say, oh, that word would spread. And people would say, yeah, they say they set it aside, but then they didn't award anything. So I guess I would be in favor of, again, the committee would be cognizant because they would have the applications in hand to know that, you know, it's, they're not competing, but they are competing in the sense that if you had a round like the one we just had, where you said these are important projects and we're going to spend all the money, that might not be the best time to apply if you were a small grant participant. Of course, you don't know that.
Right. So. We have a motion on the table?
Yes, we do. It's at 5,000. And it's still at 5 and 10. There's been discussion, and I don't know, so discussion about doing 5,000 with 5,000 total. That has not been suggested as a formal amendment. And there's been discussion around the prospect of either capping or putting a program on that. Again, it's not been offered as an amendment. So right now on the table is a $5,000 CPC contribution limit and a $10,000 total project budget. So I don't know if people want to make suggestions to amend that before we go forward with at least nailing down the amount.
Well, after the discussion, I'm either wanting that to move to a vote. I feel like the discussion has led me to think that that's too broad a set of numbers, and or we can amend it and change the numbers, but an amendment that changes the basis of the motion doesn't feel right. I think we ought to vote on that one and then recraft one if we're all thinking differently.
That's how the process works.
Okay.
So again, the motion on the table is $5,000 for a CPC contribution and $10,000 as a total budget. And as I understand Dave's language, there's no requirement of matching, or matching is not a consideration like it would be. That's one of the differences in it, right? Because you say it's being treated as per our plan except for. Right, so all in favor of these amounts, say aye.
The motion of these amounts.
Aye.
The 5,000, 10,000. So the motion on the table, 5,000, 10,000. Okay, so we have two opposed. All right, so the motion does not carry, and we are at 5 and 10. Does someone want to bring another motion forward?
That would move for 3 and 6. In part to address your amendments, 3 and 6.
Did we look at 5 and 5? That was the original language, or that?
That was the
language. Voted down?
Was, no, 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 voted down 5.
This is the first vote.
Okay.
So 3 and 6, is there a second?
Second.
Okay. All right, so what can we add? We've adjusted down to 3 and 6 from 5 and 10.
Right.
And there's no requirement for matching.
There's no requirement for matching.
But it addresses your concern about having an incentive to go out, although it's not necessary.
Right.
I mean, the only issue there is that if there's a good $5,000 project that doesn't require any additional funding, you know, if it's someone just sticking stuff in an archive envelope and it's a historical stuff that's valuable, you know, should there be requirement. But I think part of that's arbitrary. It's the difference between the 5,000 and the 7,000 and the 10,000 and something like that. I like the idea that they're encouraged to do it, and then 3,000, if that's all they get, there's still a lot can be done for 3. So I kind of like that better than the up to 5.
Okay. Any other thoughts? Okay, hearing none. The motion on the table is 3,000 CPC contribution or grant, 6,000 total project budget. All in favor? Opposed? Okay. So that motion prevails. And so the amount, this is a 3 and 6. So do we want to address right now the set aside total budget? Either a cap or a conscious set aside?
I'm comfortable with the feedback the committee has provided, which really was just reiterating what was already documented, that they're sort of getting first consideration and we can make that approval. And I think you made it clear that this can all be revisited at any time.
Yes,
so.
Yes, I can. So the next, and Dave, correct me if I'm wrong, the next big star I have is next to the type of grants. So again, this was whether or not we wanted to restrict this to a including but not limited to list, or whether we wanted to leave this open and just allow whatever project came forward that was within the budget to be at the basis of the application. So, and we had a lot of divergence at that point. Some people thought it should be restricted and others not. So
I did add in to the projects what was missing last time. People suggested is adding in the recreation related projects and also adding in a limiter in terms of rehabilitation of privately owned structures. I think that was a concern, but this housing might be easier to assist through if it was limited. So okay, that provision is in there. We can talk about it. It needs to be a little differently.
So in terms of what Dave, you had said was not appropriate. So we can't pay anyone anything for this, is that right? So any, is, the salary, if there was to be a compensation to an individual to do the work, like, and I guess for invasive work, with Broadco, they're not doing it, they're paying what's been called to do it.
Right.
Is that a salary?
No, I think that it would solely be to like pay a salary of a, into like the affordable housing support person that we voted on.
Okay, so paying someone to do the work is okay.
Paying someone to contract to do the work that's in the tent is okay, and paying to defray the cost of, solely to defray the cost of someone's salary who's already doing the job for, you know, part, you know, to pay the benefits of someone who, you know, kick in that way for an existing position or something that's going to be created. And that's what we're avoiding.
And I would also read it that, say, DPW came in and said, well, we want to do $3,000 of work and we need to pay this existing DPW employee $500 to get them to be eligible.
Right. And I'm sorry, what? It would be ineligible.
Yeah, basically the question is, you know, Dave has come up with this, and again, I thought the discussion was around whether we're providing, whether the list is providing guidance or whether the list is going to dissuade people from applying, because they'll start looking down this list and then they'll say, oh, well, there's this list, and I don't know, maybe, maybe mine's also close enough to this list that it's not going to be approved, and so I won't do my project.
Right.
They'll misinterpret it, or
if it were only the negative list, I'd go with that. But I think it's absolutely great for guidance.
Yes, and I agree.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it comes across positively. It's more inviting than...
Yeah, because I would have never even thought of the question of somebody at the DPW would apply for overtime. You know, I mean, because they're doing sign painting and it's, you know, there are just these cases that would never occur to me.
Yeah.
So I think we should put some examples in there.
Yeah. And I think, Brian, when last time we met, your idea was you don't want to study creativity, you should give the whole world. So I added in the language that we talked about. It said, this is guidance. It's not an exclusive list. The committee encouraged applicant to think creatively about other possibilities. If you're uncertain, please contact us.
Yeah. And I think it is helpful to see what is within the realm of and what is not appropriate. You did a nice job. Keep working on it.
And if other people have suggestions, I mean, this was, the list is partially as a result of the research into what other towns have funded, but also because a number of you emailed me where we had the discussion here, and you gave examples of things you think qualify or that your constituents or people you interact with might be able to apply for. So we can always change the list as you continue to have discussions as well.
I'll tell you the truth. I read it this afternoon and liked it and thought, what am I going to do to be useful in this meeting? And I couldn't think of anything I wanted to add to it. So I went and looked at the form and I thought, well, we could put the categories on the form so they don't have to go look that up, and we could see. That was the only thing I could come up with that I thought was a benefit.
I think it's, we can make a motion. Is there a motion on the table to accept?
No.
Can I make a motion to accept the language as it is? Enhancement under habitat management is just misspelled.
No, wrong. Yep, got it.
And your motion is for the new dollar amounts as?
No, we've done that.
Yeah, so this is moving on to addressing the type of grants.
Yes.
So as, basically as endorsing the language that Dave has set forward in this draft guidance document. So.
Right. Maybe I would bold this list is not exclusive.
Okay.
And the committee encourages applicants to think they have other possibilities. Just to set that.
Second, and then I'll offer a
sure.
Second.
Absolutely.
And I, as the discussion that you're now calling for. I'd suggest the last bullet on not appropriate, talking about the privately owned historic structures, which I agree with, but I think I would change the phrase that serve no public purpose, because I think it's arguable that simply enhancing, preserving historic structures, even if the private does have a public purpose. I think we were talking about public, or I recall some discussion of public access. So maybe it could be that provide no access to the public, or offer no public access, something like that. No public use. Really historic gun.
Is historic Northampton privately owned? Is that?
Yeah, they're 501(c)(3).
So they are privately owned.
What if we change it as Linda says to provide no public access or use?
Yeah, that's good.
I.e. jail folks, don't come back.
Unless you put a public community room out.
The only other suggestion for, I'm not sure that a semicolon quite works when you're talking about historic rehab. Because you're trying to describe the type of historic rehab.
Is it a colon?
Colon or dash?
And I'm not sure what you're, with habitat management, what were you trying to do there? Were you trying to, is that a dash or was that really a?
Semicolon.
Thanks. Tony, you had a comment that you emailed about the.
I did have a comment.
For individuals.
Yeah, so it says under the not appropriate, it says housing support for individuals. And I think what, having not been here, I think the intention was not to support affordable housing residents. So my comment was that in the affordable housing world, individuals and families are very specific categories. Okay. So that I thought maybe saying residents or residents of affordable housing would maybe capture more what you meant and be more specific.
Folks comfortable with residents of affordable housing?
Mm-hmm. Any comments on the first page? In the second paragraph, first sentence of the second paragraph, the sentence starts though hopefully, essentially, is the core of that sentence is that the applicants are digestible. I'm not sure that's the intention of the author.
Well, where are you?
First person.
Oh.
So I'll leave that to you.
Yep.
Later in that paragraph, the second sentence ends with program specific criteria in this plan. Until that point, there is no reference, there is no identity of a plan. So my suggestion is that at the very top, where it says small grants, at the very top of the page, the word plan being added, so that there's something for that to refer to.
I think he was assuming that this would be incorporated into the plan as a whole.
This would be a part of the whole
plan.
If
Linda's proposal was that it was to stand alone, then okay. We can amend that.
Third paragraph down, not all proposals. The second sentence currently says those that don't, it should say those that aren't. Because the prior sentence is are.
Are we wordsmithing the whole document now, or are we still on the?
I'll be happy to stop doing this.
Well, it's a digression from our discussion on the small project. I mean, on what is appropriate and what isn't.
I'll stop.
No. I mean, I think it needs to be done, but I'm unable to multitask. If we forget what we were talking about, or I will.
We seem to be covering a variety of topics, and I was simply making corrections in the text, if that's an appropriate stop.
Well, I think where we are is there's a motion and a second, and I think where Brian, he was going with this, is that it seemed like the focus was on this language, because this is the language that embodies the standards.
Okay.
So that's why I'm okay if you want to continue. We're almost to the end of the paragraphs.
Do you want to continue?
Yeah, that's fine. Just...
The paragraph is paragraph 5, this is category of projects.
Mm-hmm.
Second sentence. These generally include the preservation of river rehabilitation / restoration of open space, recreational something, historic something, and affordable housing values. And that core of that sentence is it's the preservation of values, which I don't think is the intent. And again, we could say that the general includes the preservation or rehabilitation of, and then it's basically it's a parallel structure sentence, and it would conclude that you're preserving or rehabilitating housing values. So I'm not sure, again, that's the intent. I think the sentence should be expanded to include.
Do you have alternate language to suggest?
You see what I'm saying?
Well, I do. I think it's also really hard to encapsulate we have four categories that we're responsible for.
Well, the categories I think are good to mention is just purely the grammar, the intent of the sentence was one. But I would say include preservation or rehabilitation, restoration of open space. The support of recreational.
This is the intent. We have very specific definitions for what we can do with the money. And so for preservation and rehabilitation, restoration are the two things that we're outlining we can spend money on, and then it's the four categories. I'm not sure that we can talk about support for recreational because we're not funding support.
Preservation is a verb, and recreational is an adjective.
Well, it's open space, recreational, historic, and affordable.
Recreational what?
Values. The values for each of those four categories.
So I think what he's saying to him is that the values are, in fact, what's...
It's a subject.
Okay, so what are open space, recreation, and then what do we put for historic?
Preservation.
Oh, we already have preservation, so...
Well, how about we just strike the sentence? Because we're including the table anyway. So, right. And again, I don't know that, again, I don't know that the small grant applicants are going to, right, they're not going to read the act and necessarily determine or pay a lot of attention to the difference between rehabilitation or support. So, if it seems problematic, we say categories of project, because you're going to go on to give them a long list of things that they should consider.
Well, but we're also asking them to be creative and think about other possibilities.
No, absolutely.
Given this guy. So, I mean, I'm happy to do it one way. It's just not so easy to encapsulate. I also don't want to lose track of that footnote, because if it implies you have to have purchased or acquired the property, that seems like something you want to flag for them, not have to look in a chart for it on another page.
Well, can you just put the chart right here?
Right.
You can just say categories of projects that will be considered are listed in the table below, and then you can just lay it out as a table with program area and then permitted activity.
Yep.
And then just strike that sentence back there.
Uh-huh.
And
unless I'm misunderstanding, another possible wording would be to say preservation, rehabilitation, restoration of open space, recreational or historic facilities, and affordable housing.
Except it incorporates archival. I mean, so that's the thing, it's hard to identify what historic and what to give in increases everything. So these objects, right, then you can confuse it with housing values, which is a different.
Right.
So the chart is a perfect solution, as long as you can keep it good enough.
Yes, in the chart, take out the sentence.
Perfect.
Now we're back to Brian's.
All right, so we are, so I think, since we can come back and adjust the language, but again, the motion we made was that, and the reason I'm going to this is that your motion didn't say exactly what was, I mean, you referenced Dave's language, so that's what the motion is based on the language you have in front of us. So the motion is made and seconded that we are approving of Dave's language as amended regarding those projects that will be considered in the small grant process. So all in favor? Okay, that's unanimous. So the next two items that are sort of linked were, and Dave, again, correct me if you feel that others are higher priority, timetable and decision. So, and I linked those two because we had a question of when do we want to have these presented to us, and then when do we want to make decisions on them, and we had a variety. We had them presented to us at the beginning, presented to us with the other applications later in the round. We had them be presented early, decided early, or presented early, decided late. So we never had them decided before presented. So.
True. And then I spoke with John Fry today also, and he mentioned one that we considered a year or two ago that just to get passed out on the table, which is to have rolling admission for these.
Right.
And my perspective on rolling admission is that although it would be nice and it would be great for them to have easy access to us, we have a formalized process for expedited, and I think it would be somewhat burdensome on us to have to consider them as they come in, especially as we can't always get a quorum for our meetings, and it puts a burden if we have to have a member of our committee go before the council to explain things. If we have one every round, it might get a little tiresome.
I really like knowing the full set of projects, including the small projects, and acting on the small projects with knowledge of what else is there. And I just think that works.
I would actually move to accept the process that's laid out in today's proposal, which is exactly that, that they're considered in the normal round at the outset of the meeting and voted on.
Can I ask one question under the second last paragraph?
Wait, you can't ask a question, but we'll spend a second.
So the paragraph that starts, small grants will be considered. The third sentence, the applicant therefore will not be invited to make a presentation during the meeting. If that means that we do not allow them to make a presentation. I mean, isn't our intent that they do not have to make the presentation? If so desired, would we then not hear, if they said, I would really like to present this proposal to you, this seems to me to indicate we will not hear it. Is that the intent?
Based on our conversation last time, that's the direction I thought people wanted to go.
So we,
in
if,
terms of.
If they ask, then we will not hear them.
Right, that we should be able to evaluate these on our own. And I assume that we have enough concern about the project, roll it into the regular process and give them an option to present as part of the larger one.
Donnie presented the credibility concern, you know, and that's them making a presentation is the way I would get the first take on that action. Although I might have been the very person who said no presentation. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think a limited time presentation or something might. I think we're
can't ask them any questions. And I also think different people have different strengths. And while hopefully they do have somebody who's good with words and papers and organizing, that there could be something really brought into us that we really get the feel for. I think the risk that we open up then is like, oops, you don't quite have it. Go work it again. You know, I think that there's that, because I think we're trying to avoid that.
I never remember too. I think we were trying not to put them through a paper exercise unnecessarily. That we did want, you know, presentations developed and PowerPoint presentations and pitches developed. If I do remember that piece of it.
Well, what if we compromised and said you'd be available at that meeting to answer any questions in the committee?
Yeah. I mean, I kind of feel pretty strongly that I don't want to see them. I mean, I thought that the point of this was to make a paper application. Again, I don't think I've ever applied for a grant that I had to stand up in front of the grant-making body and do a pitch. It's always, you fill out your paper, you say who you are, maybe you have your CV attached, and maybe you send pictures of previous. I mean, this is not, I mean, the point was, like, you're right, some people might not be good at organizing the paper, but then some people might be terrified of coming up and being grilled over what they think is, you know, a project that's valuable. And I thought that's what we were trying to get away from.
Okay.
And trying not to. And my other concern is that once we get in the habit of offering presentations, who's not going to come? Who's not going to feel obligated? Because everyone's going to say, well, I heard that they applied, and they got the grant, they gave a presentation, and they had, and then they brought in all these people. So then we get the thing of, now we have, again, what's the beginning of the round, and we have 8 small grant applications, each taking 30 minutes. So that's a 4-hour meeting. And I would just, again, if this is meant to be, I always thought the idea of this from its genesis was it was in contrast to our current procedure. And so I would keep it as contrasted as possible by just saying it's a paper application. Again, if they think that's not appropriate, then they're free to apply in the regular round and do a presentation and bring public support. But I would not want the committee to have to open that up, because I think that process would become very time, could become very time consuming.
I think that's true. I think the little asterisk to all of this is that we've written it that they will get some feedback. And so I did have this question about, what do we mean by that? You know, are we going to put something in writing? Is that staff's responsibility? Just really clearly, what are we committing to doing for them? I know we've talked about that. I definitely heard that in the round that I participated in, where we were saying, you know, we'd like to support them to have a stronger application, but they didn't really know what that meant. You know, they can talk to us, they can talk to Sarah or John. You know, what does that really mean to people who are reading this?
Well, I mean, again, I don't know whether we want to strengthen that language, but typically, if you're doing this and you're not expert, you need to consult with staff. You need to talk to Sarah and John and ask them, does my project qualify? And if they skip over that and they present something and we can't even tell whether it qualifies, well, they have not taken advantage of staff's ability.
I agree, and I think it says that in here that they must consult with staff. So, but this is in here, so, and I think there's merit to leaving it vague, because then we're not really committed to anything. But can you just tell me more of what the intent was? Like, what, did we think they were going to get a letter, or just that like Sarah was available to answer their questions? You know, is it on us to do something proactively to give them more information, or just that, you know, that we're saying, look, the door isn't slammed. You just need to work with us.
Which language?
What does feedback mean? So requests that fail to meet eligibility criteria or that are denied on their merit will be returned to the applicant with an explanation for the denial and how to make the application more competitive in the future. So just that very specifically, with an explanation for the denial and how to make the application more competitive. So let's say we're not seeing them, not that they might not show up and listen to us, but we're not having a back and forth with them at all.
Yeah.
Anyway. Is it that they get to listen to us and we'll find out? Or?
Yeah, I mean, anyone is able to sit in and listen to that discussion, but I think to me, it's important that if it's something that fails because of eligibility, ultimately, that they understand that it's just not eligible.
Right.
But if it fails because it's missing something, or it wasn't persuasive, or it wasn't compelling, or we didn't feel like all the information was there, that we communicate that back to them. And I think that could be through staff, or I'd rather it not be a formal letter, although I can see the view of that.
If it were a minute.
I would like to end it with an explanation for the denial, period. It may be that it's a real shit proposal and they're not gonna do it. And we're still gonna explain the denial. If it's a good proposal, we can explain how to make it more competitive. But I think it muddies it to say for all proposals, we're gonna tell you how to make it more competitive in the future. Well, maybe we aren't. But but they deserve a right for an explanation for the denial. So I would just end it there.
So one difficulty with having an explanation for denial, as a committee, we vote. We don't necessarily share, we won't necessarily share our reasons for denying. So, I mean, we might take a vote and it might be unanimous against, but then who drafts the opinion?
Like, you do. You come back.
No, I don't think, I'm not being flippant when I say it ought to be in our minutes.
Well, I know, I mean, but the idea is, this makes it sound like, we're gonna convey it, and then we're just gonna send them the minutes, because again,
our record.
Sarah, so do people come to you and say, why did I get denied?
It depends on the round and it depends on the project.
And are you comfortable with giving the explanation?
Yes.
I mean, I just know that when I go to city council and have to present your discussion, mm-hmm. I feel very uncomfortable when they say, well, what did the committee think of this? And I think, oh, they argued about it for 45 minutes and they ended up voting, you know, 5-2 for it. So what did they think of? I don't know what they thought of it. I mean, do you want me to do a blow by blow? And even if they've read the minutes, but they want the real reason, you know, it's hiding. And I just, so.
So our current practice with just in general, do people get a denial letter? Do they just?
We don't typically give them something formal. We always get in touch with them. Like Downey talked to Sean Porter from Wood Park. Sometimes I'll talk to department heads, but it depends. But they're also usually here, so we don't typically need to really get in touch.
I mean, yeah, the chair will, if something is close, I mean, I think staff communicates it if it's not even close, like you weren't eligible or you were, you know.
We ran out of money.
But like I called Brook Park because I said it was a timing issue. I didn't want them to, and again, where projects are worthy, but they're competing against other projects that are good, you might. And a lot of times that's because the committee tells the chair, please express to the applicant that it was considered an excellent project. However, it just lost out to the competition this round. So that's something the committee did. But this will make them expect that they will have a reason for denial. And again, the committee could do that, right? They could vote on that, but it's an additional task we place on ourselves and what's supposed to be a compact process. So
what if instead, just as a matter of practice, staff were to make sure that the applicants were notified that the project would be considered and voted on at this meeting, they're invited to come, but they can certainly come and observe and learn the reasons and at the meeting, so that if they're interested enough, they'll come and observe, and if they're not, they're not.
Yeah. And we'll record it too.
So all meetings are televised.
They're not televised, but they're available to stream online through ICTV, so you can get them.
So if they, you know, if there's some kind of affirmative outreach to say this is the night.
Right.
So again, with limited experience on that, when I was on the housing partnership, we did apply, and so I don't know if this is what normally happens, you know, because we certainly have a city staff person supporting us as well, but we sort of had the schedule, so we could look at, like, this is when things are happening, and this is the meeting. Like, we knew that at the get-go when we applied. I don't know if everyone sort of knows.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's sort of built in.
So,
but I'm thinking that the small grant applicants are maybe a little less sophisticated, and if what we're trying to do is encourage them that taking that extra step might be useful to make it a more welcoming environment to actually say.
Yeah, I kind of have a form letter together for all the applicants anyway. I could make a separate one with a small grant.
Yeah, form letter.
That would do it.
I think a form letter is a good idea.
So people agree we want to remove this sentence altogether. If that makes sense. Without taking a vote.
So we're moving the first want to add Linda's suggested procedure, or do we just make that the practice of the committee that?
I'm happy that.
You want to memorialize that?
No, I'm happy that just being the practice.
Okay.
And I also think this has changed since it was originally written to require the applicant to work with staff before submitting it, so there would be opportunity to talk about the timing and what they can and should do. That's good.
All right, any further discussion? So.
I'd like to revisit the, once again, the would not be invited. I mean, I do think our intent is to democratize the process, to have community, more community participation. That's what we specifically are asking for. I think we could say the applicant therefore will not be required to make a presentation during the meeting. If kids want to come because they're proposing an addition to their playground, and well, you know what, you're not invited to speak to us. I mean, we're a town committee to not allow, will not be invited to me is, no, kids, you can't come tell us why your school needs playground equipment. I think that's very uninviting. And again, if our intent is to broaden community participation, maybe, you know, I don't want a 4-hour meeting, so we could say we'll not be required. I just think it's unkind to not invite, to make explicitly not invite people to tell us what they're proposing.
Yeah, I take your mind. I mean, there's always public comment, so we can't, right? If they want to come and make a presentation, we can't stop them. So but yeah. If you want to change it, I mean, I'm fine with changing it from will not be required or will not be expected. And just see it again, the committee can.
I guess no one's required, are they?
Right, no one's required.
Have we had times when no one's?
Oh, yeah.
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 Okay, so we'll not be expected to make a presentation. I mean, that's not quite as harsh as we're not being invited.
I don't know what your form letter looks like, but I almost think, you know, in the spirit of that, that it might include something about, like, if you feel compelled to say something, it can happen during public comments. Are our public comments limited to?
No.
3 minutes.
Well, only in exceptional circumstances.
No, because that's the invitation.
If you're then saying, please come in the back door.
I mean, the other compromise would be to say, the presentation of no more than 5 minutes, or that you come to the meeting and available for questions from the committee, not to make the presentation. And that, I foresee that we could get an application minute that we say no to because there's one point that's not clear, which if it could have been clarified in the meeting, you know, we might vote the other way. And those types of things happen. But I also see down the point, which is then you open up the discussion. And is it really 5 minutes? Does it turn to 10 minutes? Or do you have more?
Again, I just think that when we get, it seems to me like the process is designed to have, like as you envisioned it, just bird boxes. Here's a picture of the bird box I want to build. And I think if we are all to the point where we're having to have questions and really we need to look them in the eye to see whether they can carry the project through, it sounds to me like, again, I have no confidence in my ability to tell what someone's telling the truth. They're people are terrible at that. So they're gonna get up and say, yeah, we're gonna do it. And we're gonna say, great. And I don't see the value to necessarily have them testify.
I don't know.
Not under oath.
Well, we have the language that says if we have questions, we can let you know and you can be considered for the full round. Probably that's the best way.
Yeah, I mean, here's our.
I would agree. We're trying to do simple, and I know it's hard for us to all let go of all of these steps and bounds and whatever, but let's go for simple. Let's do it.
And again, if it doesn't work, right, if we're shooting down all the projects because we each have one question, then it seems like we could, in the next round in the spring, say, oh, let's open it up a little bit.
I agree, because I think that if somebody really has some time-sensitive thing that they really need money and they're hustling to pull it together, then I really would expect them to speak with staff to make sure that they're gonna navigate this the best they can. I mean, I think Sarah can anticipate many of the questions the committee would have if it's not clear, so I feel comfortable with it. Just deleting that request that failed me eligibility line.
Okay, and we've changed to expect.
And change to, will not be expected to make a presentation.
So again, the motion was to approve the language that Dave has drafted on procedure. It has been slightly amended. Is there further discussion?
I'm sorry, so again, the second last paragraph, beginning with alternatively, that's in brackets?
Yes, that was.
Why? That's just removing the brackets?
No, that's so that the, as I understand it, as proposed, that we will hear the applications at the beginning, and that at that meeting, at the beginning, we will make our recommendations to be passed on to the council immediately for their consideration. Right. And the brackets was the competing alternative, which was recommend at the beginning and present to council as a package with other recommendations at the end.
I would like to have that option. I guess the scenario is we get, this won't happen, but we get 10 or 20 applicants, that's $30,000 or $60,000. I would not be, and it isn't competition. Why can't we just take the brackets out and keep this alternatively at this main committee group? It just leaves our options open. We can decide then. I think the preferred thing is they come in, it's one and done, we're good, they got their $3,000. But there may be a time that we really, it's just the money is such an issue. Why not broaden our ability to, our flexibility?
I think Dave has left us the out with the clause or the phrase, to the extent practicable. So he said in that first sentence, to the extent practicable, and so maybe that's when we have a funding round where we think we're going to be stretched financially, and that could be the reason.
Oh, I see. Okay, so that's the outcome.
That's one potential outcome.
Yeah, I think to the extent practical this evening, we ought to try to decide which direction we generally want to go in, because we want to be able to tell applicants this is what you could normally
do. I didn't see the extent practical. That's a nice out.
So, any further discussion?
So, as for the purpose of the motion, we would strike that.
Yes, we're striking the alternative in the brackets. All right. So, no further discussion. All in favor of that procedural language? Unanimous. All right, so let's type in timetable, the form of the application is the next item I have, which again, you have the document.
David still had other comments he wanted to make.
Okay.
That, I don't know if you want to do that now or afterwards, or if there are, you had other comments on that?
Oh, just a lot.
If they're stylistic, I'm happy to consider them.
Yeah, a lot are stylistic, right? I'm happy to share it with
you. Yeah, exactly.
Can you, once this is done, just send us and we can do a little more wordsmithing? The style stuff, is that appropriate?
Well, not really. I don't think so. Usually when you draft, you have to appoint a subcommittee that's responsible for drafting, and then they have to meet, and then they have to edit.
The subcommittee, do you have subcommittee in one, like they?
Has been.
Yes. I mean, you don't have a problem with him talking with any other members of his subcommittee. He's the only one, so that way you avoid the open meetings problem. But I mean, all of us sending him comments that he'll then roll in is, I think, deliberation outside of those emails would constitute deliberation outside of the meeting. So.
Besides that, I'm actually wanting to come to get to the end. this process.
So we can, why don't we come back to any textual, specific textual changes, and let's, if we can move on to the next, which is the application form, joiner eligibility application form that he drafted.
And I will say, the format is a byproduct of me not being able to manipulate the boxes and text boxes, so I would assume, you know, if the content is okay, we can have Sarah try to reformat it so that it affords the proper space and also looks a little bit nicer. So what I did here was basically take the instruction form and based on the suggestions last time, to make it easier, take all the questions that were in the instruction form and incorporate them into the combined form. So it was basically answer all these questions and then here's the list of attachments that you need to provide. And I agree that it looks a lot better and somewhat more comprehensive on the other end. Not as concise, but comprehensive and logical. And perhaps still the type of.
May I ask a quick question for Brennan's page?
You can ask whatever you like.
Okay. E and F seem to not have similar language. And I'm not sure if it's the same thing.
E and F under number 6.
Yeah.
6E and 6F.
Discussion was you had it much briefer, Dave, in your original thing, and it was, well, does it meet our needs? And we thought no. The question would be, is filling out a 4-page questionnaire going to weed people out? And I don't think so. You could write one or two sentences on each of these. Which is understandable. I don't think it's an over. Bureaucratization, even if it's for $3,000.
Is the only question I would have is, so these are borrowed from our regular application, all of these questions. Is there anything else that you would want from a small applicant? Thank you. Right, is there anything unique about this process or about the applicant or the back
end
of the bridge? Is there sort of an overview? You know, give us a overview of the project?
There's a...
I know there's like the end or anything else.
Well, the
project summaries.
Yeah, budget summary.
Yeah, and maybe there should be more space there. Summarize the project.
Oh, I thought you were doing that by answering questions 1 and 2.
Yeah, I think, what if we change it to project summary, please provide a brief description of the project, leave space, and then have question number 1 after it, the project location.
Why not give it a number so that it's clear? Project summary, number.
Okay. Well, that's good.
Because I'm a fool.
clarify for me. Question two is asking what community preservation criteria, both general and program specific, does the project need? So, two pages earlier, they had to check the CPA program area, open space, historic preservation. So, it's almost like I want to tie those two together or put that explanation back with that check the box and just say, explain how.
Well, I think the intent on that is that they would, I can put a note, that they would actually look at the specific criteria that we have in the plan, as opposed to just check the box under, does it satisfy rehabilitation? But we have, you know, a list of...
So these are our planned criteria?
Right, yeah.
Okay.
That makes sense to cross-reference the plan and the pages.
Yeah, because I read it thinking that was where you needed to tell them which of the four program areas and make them explain to us what they were doing. I didn't read it in their plan.
We can make a link too, so it's quote general. You could click on general and it would take you to that part of the plan and then part of the program specific one.
That'd be nice.
Just to make sure that
no, it's great.
We have every opportunity to read it.
Can I ask, though, is that really helpful? People who have reviewed more applications than I have, is that section where people are kind of, I'm going to color this by the way I ask the question, regurgitate what it says in the plan. It may, yes, I need all these criteria. I will support this. I'll enhance this. Has that actually been helpful? If you say yes, then I would leave this in. If no, then it's kind of putting people through an exercise that really may not be providing much useful information to the committee. But it's really an open question because I don't know.
I think the answer is sometimes. Hmm. And a lot of times it isn't, because you're right. It's simply regurgitation of the plan.
With experienced grant writers, they tend to just regurgitate the plan and tell you how they support every goal that's ever been considered under all program areas.
Right.
But it does, I think it's helpful for me usually to remind me of the fact that, oh, that's what they're supposed to be. And then, or if they make an assertion, sometimes I'm skeptical of that. They say they're supporting, you know, community housing. I'm like, exactly, how is that happening? But that's a lot, I think they have to get guidance from Sarah as to how they might, you know, what, because we have even our applicants in our normal rounds are not particularly good at picking out. Like they check all four boxes. That's usually the first procedure on the eligibility forms, to check all of them. And then we have a conversation where Sarah has a conversation and says, yeah, I think it's probably just the one. And I'm like, okay, can we just check this one also? I'm like, no, it's just the one. But I don't, I mean, some, if I see it's just the boilerplate that's been cut and pasted, then I usually ignore it. But I would hope that they would spend a little more time with their initial applicants.
It does also seem like the practice for funders to ask you to tell them exactly what they could reference somewhere else, you know, like you shift the burden onto the person asking. So what you're saying is like, oh yeah, like right, that's in my experience, it's like you always have that burden. You think, you know this is what you do, why are you making me tell you? But that seems to be the way it is, right? And maybe that is just for those reasons, I don't know.
Well, and I think there's opportunities. Not everyone here is an expert in field, and so sometimes it's nice for them to tease out what the connections are that would not necessarily be obvious. And when that happens, it's joyous, because other times, you're right, it's kind of like they throw everything at you and then you become more skeptical. But that lends itself to, are they credible or are they good fire? But I think if we explain what it's precisely what we're looking for, and that they identify it and explain the relationship, without requiring a lot. Imagine there aren't going to be as many projects here that are going to serve multiple purposes. So it should be a pretty short section.
Is there anything here that says this is the limit? The spaces that we're giving you, whatever it ends up being, is the limit?
The limit of what?
The limit of word limit, word space word. Limit.
No, I specifically included if you need additional space for any of these, feel free to add more.
Do we want to do that?
It seems to reduce the likelihood that the committee might have other questions that we then need somebody to come and answer.
means that it will be given, the application will be given more weight, and often that just confuses things and leads to a longer process. Is there?
You're saying that to a lawyer?
From one lawyer to another lawyer.
That's the, you know, I just can't see that we can limit. People hopefully won't go on and on. Some of the proposals are way too long, but it is what it is.
Good. The way that people get around that anyway, unless we specifically tell them not to, is just look at attachments. Look at all these attachments I have for you, and then they end up squeezing.
Some applications really do have limitations. You've got to do it on 2 pages or 5 pages, or that's it, and you figure out.
Or 50 words. One's online now, they have a word count, and if you go over it, they say you cannot submit. So you have 51 words in the box.
Sometimes it keeps deleting the end.
I'm not sure that that's, you know, that's subverting the public process.
We could have the best of both. We could just, at the beginning of the form, say, try to answer in the space provided. And then it's not a restriction that's hard.
That's a nice answer.
But it just says, we're not really expecting you to do a whole lot more than that.
Right. I think that would be fine. Just something to say, really, this is enough.
People agree? Well, then it's the maker of the motion.
What she friendly amendment.
So we've got also that small amendment to the application document. Right. Any other consideration? Actually, no, this is new. I don't think we have a motion on the table for this one. We're just talking around it. Would anyone like to make a motion to approve this application?
I'm going
to
re-approve the application for small grants.
Oh, the entire application?
So this application form as it has been.
Okay.
But
David has more wordsmithing stuff, correct?
Just a small one, I'll share with David probably if it substantially changed.
Second.
All right. So all in favor, if there's no further discussion. All in favor? All right. So we have eligibility form and application. We have our amount. We have decided on appearance is not required or not. And we have the type of grants nailed down. We have a timetable for the decisions and the recommendations. I think that's all I have on my list, Dave. Something I'm sure I am.
You have a question?
Yes.
We just assume that Dave's going to change the 4999 to 3,000, 6,000.
Yes.
Is there any explanation needed for what is the difference, for what is in the 4,500 and $6,000? What is like kind? Is this applicant going to know how to tell us what that is, if it's not, particularly if it's not money?
So I changed it from in-kind and matching funds, so that in-kind kind of leads away. If they have in-kind, that's great. As part of the narrative, so it really just specifies matching funds.
Okay.
And then in the project budget thing,
so I'm imagining that he's going to bring it back and then have an easy vote as to sort of the form of all the documents.
Oh, I thought we were getting to vote. This was it.
Well, I don't think we can approve something that we don't have.
Okay.
So I would think that we would all want to see the final documents before we say we want to go.
You all are slower than the government.
Well, this can be an easy vote.
So right now it just says funding from other sources. That I have funding from other sources and dollar amount, and then I'll list in kind, ask them to list any in kind contributions. That makes sense.
Where are you?
In the application form.
Page 3, you're looking at that, but it's somewhere here or somewhere.
page three.
Yeah.
So it would be CPA, total project budget, CPA funding request, funding from other sources, and then list any in-kind contribution of labor or materials.
Unless you wish to make a motion to delegate to the staff to finalize that and materials, which is also fine by me.
I'm comfortable with that. I think we ironed it out in my mind. And if we do not, I still don't feel constrained. I think we could, you know, I could bring it up again if something really stumbled.
So where's that leave us?
That leaves, I mean, I think those are all the issues that I had flagged from our previous discussion. Since maybe we have, I think we've gone through virtually every line of the new language dealing with small grants that
we're writing for Dave.
And we have gone through the application, so we're right across.
Do we want me to revise this?
So I think that was Devin's motion.
Devin moves that Dave revise the instructions and the form as discussed tonight and get it to staff, who will then circulate it to us in as the completed document. But I think it is finishable that way.
Yeah. My question. Do we want me to revise the narrative so that it is a standalone, I would think, or a standalone amendment to the plan?
I believe that that was Linda's suggestion, that we have it as standalone language.
I think for now it should be standalone.
Yeah.
If we want to put it in the plan whenever we're going to be done with the plan, that's fine. But if we want this for this round, it should be standalone.
Right. I mean, because it will probably go up on the website as new for fall 2015 small grants, and then your language shouldn't reference the plans, as it won't just be there itself.
All right. But any cross-reference to the plan should be to the current plan for page numbers, or
yes,
is what we'll use the new eligibility chart for cross-references.
Yeah. So this will be effective for September.
That's the intent. But when you get the final document circulated, don't respond to Sarah with comments on changes, because that would be deliberation.
To Sarah?
Yeah, because that would be basically him making a, and also, which I don't know how you could do that, because the committee hadn't voted on it.
Well, and you know what, I have no reason to push this tonight. I mean, we've got other meetings,
yeah.
Let's just circulate it and do it in mass when it's time.
It's fine to, again, because when is our August meeting, sir?
We don't
know.
We have a July meeting.
Yeah,
we have
July,
a
July meeting.
Yeah.
Okay, we're good.
So.
When is our July meeting?
15th.
Just talk,
yeah.
All right. John? Yes.
I would like to express my appreciation and thanks to David for originating this and a lot of work, and also for helping us this evening, shepherding the, responding to all the questions from the committee and putting this together. It represents a significant effort, and I appreciate it.
Here, here. Yes.
Thanks, Ollie.
Perseverance.
Yes.
So the third Wednesday in July is the 15th. Is that our date?
That's the date we
got. Yes. So we had on that agenda a public hearing on the plan. I don't know if we're ready to do that.
No.
Which is okay. That's fine. But then the more we push that off, the more it means that this existing plan will guide applicants for the upcoming round.
It brings up the question, is there any, I mean,
I'm sure the town goes and looks at what happened tonight, but is there any need to have a public hearing about this small grant proposal? I mean, is that, if we're not doing the plan in July, should we?
We haven't typically, I mean, when we did the expedited review criteria, we didn't have a standalone public hearing for it.
The one thing that we're absolutely required to have a public hearing on is the community preservation need. So what does the community think is important to spend CPA funds on?
I'm sorry, is the what?
So the needs of Northampton for community preservation. No one ever comes to the community.
And we host that meeting? And have we done this before? And no one's ever come? Do we have to do it again this for the preparation?
We've done it every time we update the plan.
I need to call the press.
Which we've done in the past, but no.
So I have on my calendar, I know we all just said there's no August meeting, August 5th, council chambers finalized fall run, funding round dates. Is that just not happening on August 5th? I don't know why I have that.
I have a meeting for August 5th also.
Yeah, we put aside an August 5th meeting in case we needed to have one. But otherwise, we were planning.
All right, well, given that the plan is not on our agenda tonight, we cannot deliberate. However, at our last meeting, we had assigned Linda and Tony to reviewing the housing section. Brian and I were looking at open space. Dave and David were looking at historic. Rec, we had not designated anyone other than Glenn, who was not here at that meeting. Deb and I have your name written off to the side because I think you were doing the global assessment.
Okay.
So, again, there's no need to make changes if none seem appropriate. So, as you read it, you're satisfied. That's great. But if you think change is appropriate, then come with them to our next meeting and we'll vote.
So for the July 15th meeting.
Okay. If there's no other business, a motion to.
Actually, I.
Oh.
That's good. Very good.
It's so enlightening.
I think we need to revisit Downey's resignation.
No, I'm not
being facetious or silly. We need a new chair by September, which means someone needs to step up by next meeting, is that correct? I mean, next meeting will be your last?
Quite, yes, unless we have an August meeting.
Okay, and the intent is not to have an August meeting. So we need to, so someone needs to put forward someone else or themselves
indeed
for chair at the next meeting, right?
Sounds like vice chair. Some are born great, some have greatness thrust upon them, right?
Can I move to amend the bylaw to affirmation to allow the re-election of the current president until further notice?
It's not possible. 13th Amendment forbids it. yes, no, I was trying with my chair's report. I thought that yes, you have sensed the full seriousness.
Okay.
And this the same thing happened to me. I was vice chair. Next thing you know, the chair left. I found myself in this chair, Brian.
No, I don't think I make a good chair, nor do I want to be chair. What did the president say? I will not, if asked, I will not run. If nominated, I will not serve.
If elected, I will not serve.
Yes.
Yeah.
Nominated,
I
will not run. If elected, I will not serve. So yeah, but so we should be thinking about nominations and.
Shall I just cut up some straws?
We could. We could do that.
Just make them all the same way.
So that is it. That would be on our agenda.
Yes.
For July, as well as the. So we're supposed to come up in July with our revisions for the plan.
Yes. And then we'll half an hour meeting at most.
Well, are we going to try to finalize the funding dates so that we don't need that on this, or the fall round
dates? Yeah.
One other thing for the whole committee, because it was discussed as we were coming in, is that I have had the same thing happen, and I'm now chair of planning board, and I think we've reallocated our collateral assignments. So I need to go back and figure out if I'm still on this committee or if someone else from the planning board is taking this committee.
And may I ask if, Dave, are you running again? May I ask that?
You can ask anything you like.
Are you running again?
Move to it, Jeff.
Second.
It's not debatable.
I mean,
all in favor?
Aye.